everybody, and welcome back to SFF 180. Thomas here, your host, as always. Thank you so much for joining me. I am coming to you from my lovely hotel room, the Churchill Hotel in Washington, D.C. I know that I promised you guys before I left on this trip that I would be sort of trying to keep the channel ticking over somewhat regularly with video updates and new content about the trip. I'm sorry that I have not been doing that quite as promised, but you know how it is. Trips are trips. They take on a life of their own. As you get into doing things, it can be very difficult to set time aside, to do, excuse me, everyone, I need to vlog really quickly, but I'm here and it's great to see all of you. Good to talk to all of you. As you might have noticed, I'm not doing like my traditional format of, WorldCon vlog that I've done in the past. Didn't really feel, wasn't really feeling it this year. Wasn't really sure that, there would be the material to record for something like that this year, to be honest with you. Because, of course, we're in very strange times, right? The shadow of Omicron right now is, of course, looming over all of us. It is even impacting the conference right now. In fact, we just got an email today from the CONCOM. Somebody on convention staff has tested positive. And they're all like, don't worry, he's self-isolating off-site. He's not coming back to the convention. The people that he was with are not coming back to the convention. Everybody's testing, but we just, we're doing our responsibility of letting you all know. So hopefully that's not going to be a thing that has too devastating an impact on all of this, but it's a thing that's there, right? It is ever present. And in fact, last night I was talking to Sean Duke, my buddy Sean from the Skiffy and Fanti podcast, about how the convention this year has this funny vibe, hovering over it, right? This almost, I don't want to be like super dramatic about it, but this quasi-apocalyptic feeling, not quite perhaps as if we are on the cusp of something like Station 11, but still, it's this thing that is kind of hovering over it, where we're all trying to maintain this normalcy of going back to conventions and in dealers' rooms and panels and cafe clatches and what have you. But doing it with the precautions of the vaccine passports and the masking and all of that, but it's still there. It's still a thing that we're aware of that's always kind of hovering. And so all you can do is use common sense. Don't expose yourself or anyone that you know, any of your friends, to any unnecessary risk. Be responsible, be an adult. And apart from that, just get on with your business, right? I'm triple vaxxed. I mask up everywhere I go, and when I don't have to be at the convention hotel, I'm not. Like right now, right? Many of the panels that I have been wanting to see, most of them have a virtual element, including the panel that I am on tomorrow afternoon at 5:30 Eastern Time. I am on the How to Start a Podcast panel. Of course, I'm not a podcaster. I'm a booktuber, right? But I am on the panel as like the token booktuber to talk about that end of things. That is going to be a fully virtual panel, so I will not be at the convention hotel doing that panel. I'll be here in my cozy, lovely room, on a Zoom call, and that's how that panel is going to go. So, I'm doing my best to just sort of be Mr. Common Sense about all of it. Otherwise, how has the trip been going, Thomas? Well, the trip's been going fine. It's actually been quite wonderful. Again, just despite all the weirdness of the times, right? You make the best of your life as you can. And I flew up from Texas, not into D.C., as I may have already mentioned, but I flew into New York City many days before the con started. I flew into JFK so that I could take in the Genesis show at Belmont Park, which I very much wanted to do because this is going to be their last tour ever. As an aging Gen Xer who saw his very first Genesis concert, I'm going to age myself horribly here, but 39 years ago in Houston. Yeah, so this is, it's nice to kind of come full circle with them on their final tour. So I'm glad I got to see that. It was awesome. And then the following day, I took the Amtrak, the Acela, from Penn Station in New York to Union Station down here in D.C., and I've been here at the hotel ever since. And the first few days of my trip involved doing the touristy things, hitting some of the museums down on the National Mall, the National Gallery of Art, of course, which is just a place that I always have to hit anytime I come to D.C. That museum is an absolutely, it's a full-day trip, just the National Gallery, right? I bumped into, of all people, fellow booktuber Paul Weymouth in the subway at completely at random. I roomed with him as well as Joe from Final Blow Joe in Dublin in 2019. We got an Airbnb together. So, you know, he's an old buddy. And just I was at the Metro Center hub station here going up the escalator when I could have sworn behind me, I heard someone going, Thomas, Thomas. And it's like, no, no, it's not me. It's just somebody else. No one could possibly know me here, right? But it was Paul. And so it was nice to bump into him. And he and I took in a couple of places. The Air and Space Museum, of course, which, you know, I have always loved to go to. But this year it was a bit disappointing because most of it is shut down for massive renovations, which makes sense because it's a museum that's been around for a while now. And apart from like some of the really, really historical exhibits, I think it is probably well past time for the museum to be updated to the state that the space program is at now, right? As opposed to just, it can't all be Saturn V rockets and space shuttles anymore, right? I mean, we need to talk about all the Mars probes and, you know, the Venus flyby and landing on comets and everything we're doing now. So it's probably well overdue, you know, for for a paint job and a bit more. So it was disappointing to go to for the time being. I'm sure it'll be awesome when it reopens in full, whenever that is. But we also went to the Arts and Industrial Building, which is right by the main Smithsonian Castle, and we took in a really cool exhibit called Welcome to the Futures, which on the one hand felt like, you know, all that stuff from like when we were kids and also maybe from like world fairs in the past, right? Where it's all about in the future, we will have jetpacks and, you know, that kind of thing, right? And in fact, they even had some old World's Fair artifacts from, you know, like the, especially like the really famous World's Fairs, like 1939, 1964, what have you. But it is all about how science and technology, as well as art, is going to sort of influence future developments to improve quality of life. And so, you know, they're talking about, you know, there was a full-size mock-up of a flying taxi, you know, which I can't wait to see those crashing all over the place, but they had a mock-up there. And it'd be interesting to see if that actually gets developed. There was a Hyperloop pod, you know, for the new proposed, you know, maglev ultra high speed train thing. And there was just all kinds of different stuff about sustainability and renewability and how that might be shaped in the future. And it actually had a very big science fiction adjacent element to it. There were displays on just various topics where linked to the display, you could scan a QR code and download a science fiction story, an original story, based on whatever that particular display was about. And there were six or seven or eight of them total. And they were all written either by Madeline Ashby, which is cool because she is a futurist, and that's really kind of interesting, or Tochi Onyebuchi. And I had no idea that they had done these, so I downloaded all those to my phone to read later. And they also had on display Octavia Butler's typewriter, which is why, you know, it's kind of like seeing Jimi Hendrix's guitar, you know, or John Coltrane's saxophone, you know, it's like the, ooh, wow, it's where it all came from. Yeah. So, you know, the acknowledgement of the role of art and creativity in developing the ideas that then actual technologists will take and turn into real things that improve our life is very much part of that exhibit. So I was glad to go to that. But beyond that, now the convention has started, and it is interesting to have a Worldcon, first off, again happening in a hotel, as opposed to some massive convention center taking up three city blocks, right? Like it's been for the last few years, right? I mean, you know, Finland and Ireland and San Jose and what have you. You know, we're back into a hotel now. It's a big hotel. It was not the con's first choice for a hotel. They lost their first choice because the place went out of business. So they ended up in this new hotel, the Omni Shoreham. I don't know exactly how new or old the building itself is. It's very stately and luxurious looking on the inside. Perhaps not the best for a full accessibility when it comes to, say, disabled attendees. You know, you'll see a lot of ramps and a lot of elevator banks all around, but then there are other areas where suddenly there's just some weird accessibility thing. Like, you'll need to go down 3 or 4 steps to get into a particular room, and there's no way around those steps. It's like, okay. So that's not exactly good planning. And it has led to, like, some real issues here at the convention, especially, like, one of the panel rooms is a very tiny room set way off in the back of the building that's tiny enough to, like, not really have room for someone in a wheelchair who needs that space to be able to maneuver. And, you know, that's just not fair. You know, it's one of those things. Always, I'm sure, logistical nightmares constantly pop up when you're trying to plan a conference like that. But something like that really, you know, the due diligence needs to be done well in advance. I'm not in a position to lecture anyone who has ever run a con or volunteered on a con as to how to do their jobs. I would not be that presumptuous. But I think that it's one of those things that any observer could look at and say, yeah, this could have gone better, right? Apart from that, though, having it in a hotel was a little bizarre at first until I actually, you know, on the night before the con started, began to explore the hotel quite a bit. And there is a lot there, right? It is a massive, sprawling complex. It's almost like the, you know, the Overlook and the Shining, right? It just feels like once you get into the area of the hotel that is built for conferences and events and what have you, it is just this endless labyrinth of corridors and meeting rooms, and you just follow it, and then another space opens up at the back where more corridors and hotel rooms just seem to spread out into infinity, and then you keep going and keep going, and then another area seems to open up, and even more. So it's almost like a little pocket universe in there. So it's certainly, the building itself, I think, is certainly equipped to host an event with a great many attendees, you know, probably as many attendees as you might get at a typical WorldCon, a pre-plague WorldCon, right, where there might be 7,000-8,000 people. I'm not sure how many people are in actual attendance this year. Probably the whole thing of scheduling it in a hotel may have been done on the expectation that there would be a dramatically reduced in-person attendance this year as a result of COVID-19. I mean, I know that between a lot of, you know, I talked about the BookTube posse, right? Folks not turning up. Well, there were any number of reasons for that, right? Either people simply could not get off of work, or they're just still too nervous to travel while COVID is looming. Or they may live out of the country in another country that has right now current restrictions, rules in place in terms of, you know, where you can go and if you can leave and if you can come back and all of that. So, you know, these things are just out of the individual's control, right? So as it happens, I think the convention is certainly not without its teething troubles. Registration was a nightmare. We all kind of endured it. I like to think I'm kind of a chill person generally, but of course I can lose my patience like anyone else, but I was just determined not to let any of this get to me, because what purpose does it serve, right? I mean, when you're in the registration line, and I got in it, it was long, and I'm like, oh God, but what can I do? And as it happened, it only got longer after that, right? It just went on and on and on. You know, but what good does it do to be like that person, to be that guy, that lady in the line who's like, I've been in this line for 3 hours, and anyway, wait, blah, blah, blah. What are you accomplishing? I mean, do you think that, you know, just losing it is going to, like, cause some wave of magic to appear and all the congestion and, you know, problems that are facing the, you know, there's printers that don't work and, you know, lack of staffing, you know, too few volunteers to handle the all these issues that are just coming up. Do you think they'll just magically go away because you lose your temper and yell and complain at somebody who is volunteering their time, not even being paid for this? You know, just grow up, be an adult, right? Just DBAA, right? The old, you can work out that acronym for yourself. So, so far I have though been having quite a good time. Met up with several friends, have taken in some wonderful restaurants. Last night, again, with Sean Duke and Paul Weimer also from the Skiffy and Fanti show, we had a wonderful dinner at Afghan Grill near the convention hotels. Fantastic. Night before last, met up with my dear, dear friend, Stina Light. She and I had Indian food at this amazing place called Non Wise. where when you tell them to spice your food up, they don't dick around, right? Like I told them, like, they have all their spice levels, and you know, I'm ordering my chicken vindaloo, and I say, they say, how spicy do you want it, sir? And I say, Desi. And they kind of give you this look like, okay, white boy. And they bring the food. Yeah, it was nuclear and it was worth it. The food's been fantastic. Also by my hotel, I've had, you know, been to a Thai place and another Indian place. And so that's something that I very much, I want to just hit all of the really awesome looking restaurants, you know, by the hotels. So that has been very satisfying. And there are other writers here, of course, that I know, but I just have not bumped into them yet. If I do, I do. You know, maybe I'll see some of them at the Hugo ceremony tomorrow night otherwise. But that is it. That is really kind of my Worldcon trip report for Friday. And it is, you're going to be seeing this, of course, Saturday morning early. But like I said, it's been wonderful to be here. It's been great to talk to all of you. You know, I will probably have more to report on, let's say, after the Hugos, perhaps, if I feel up to it, if I feel awake enough, you know, maybe I'll shoot you guys a little something, or maybe I'll just leave it as a community post on the channel, as well as, you know, on the Twitter, Instagram, what have you. You know, I'll take plenty of pictures and leave it on the SFF180.booktube Instagram. That's another place you guys can follow me if you want some of those updates. So anyway, thank you all so much. Love you to pieces. Again, you know, thanks for being the very best viewers in all of BookTube. And until I see all of you next time, snap, snap. Stay safe and stay healthy. And happy reading.